In the name of our mighty and great God, in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, and in the name of our powerfully present Holy Spirit, welcome to Wesley United Methodist Church. Welcome to worship with Wesley United Methodist Church. My name is Steve Blackshear, your pastor here, and it is a great honor and pleasure to be gathered with you for worship today in this online worship format. And I just want to remind you that whenever we gather together, we do so not only in the presence of God, but in our mission here at Wesley United Methodist Church, our purpose, our driving reason for being, and that is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And as we move deeper into this journey of Lent, that's exactly what we're doing, because we're moving deeper into our sermon series called Living the Prayer We Pray, focusing in on Jesus' teaching about prayer and about living as a disciple. And so I look forward to sharing in today's sermon with you. Before we move any further, I do have a question for you, though. Have you ever had a dog? Or maybe you have one now. And if you have had or have a dog now, have you ever tried to train it to just do some simple basic commands? Think that through, and if you've had that experience, think about what it was like, and we'll come back to that later. But right now, I just want to remind you that you can, and I encourage you, to go to our online worship bulletin. You can pull it up on our website. In fact, there's a link at the bottom of the video here, where you can go directly to the website page that has the bulletin on it. You can see the order of worship. You can see other things that you'll be needing for worship, and there are announcements there. And as always, I just encourage you to ask any questions, reach out and connect with us as you need to about anything that you see there in that bulletin. But now I invite us to move into worship, and I invite you to sing with us about the amazing love and grace of our God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Grace that taught my heart
Listen now to a scripture from the New Testament book of Hebrews, chapter 4. Indeed, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints and marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And before Him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested and tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. And then a passage of scripture from the New Testament book of James, chapter 1. Blessed is anyone who endures temptation. Such a one has stood the test and will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love Him. No one, when tempted, should say, "I am being tempted by God." For God cannot be tempted by evil, and He Himself tempts no one. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. Then, when that desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And that sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Several years ago, when my wife and I, we gave in to our young son's request to have a dog, we got our first family dog. Of course, the boys promised faithfully to train and take care of the dog. But as maybe it has happened in your experience with dogs and young children, that really fell to my wife and I. And so it was a puppy, a Labrador puppy. And when it got to the right age, it was a female. Her name was Ellie. When she got to the right age to start training her, we started working with her on basic commands. Sit, stay, come, heel, those kinds of things. Now, getting her to understand and be obedient to the command to sit was fairly easy. But then when we moved on to the command to stay, even when you would start to walk away, this was something that proved very difficult for Ellie. After all, she loved to be around you. She loved to be petted by you and loved on by you. And she just didn't like the fact that you were walking away. And so when she began to try to stay put, even when you had just gotten a step or two away, you could see it in her eyes. You could see the twinges in her muscles. She oh so wanted to move, and then she just couldn't do it any longer. And here she would come, bounding over to you. But over time, after being consistent in trying to communicate to her the expectation and having her stay longer and longer periods, and then certainly rewarding her when she did be obedient, over time, she got really good at it, where you could tell her to stay, and she would be in the backyard, and you could walk all the way out of the backyard and even leave the gate open, and she would stay put. But it was hard. It was hard for her to do that. You know, I've heard that dogs often take on the personalities or characteristics of their owners. In fact, this past week, I even read that there's been a university study that has proven that. And I believe that when it comes to finding it difficult or even impossible to resist temptation to do something really desirable, like coming to you as a dog when you know you're supposed to stay put, when it comes to resisting that temptation to do something really desirable, even though it's wrong, I'm guessing that dogs do take on a similar characteristic and trait of their owners, or for that matter, most human beings, because we have the same difficulty too. And with that, I would like for you to hear the words of Scripture for our sermon. They again come to us from Matthew chapter 6, and we'll be reading verses 9 through 13. These are Jesus' words as he's teaching his disciples. Pray then in this way: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of temptation. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God indeed. And do not bring us into temptation. Traditionally, in the Lord's Prayer that is used in public worship, that phrase is said this way: and lead us not into temptation. And you might be wondering, why do we need to pray this? I mean, does God really bring or lead us into temptation to sin? Why would God do that? And if there's a good reason, let's say God does that, and if there's a good reason for God to lead us into temptation, why should we be praying that God not do the very thing God knows is best or good for us? Any of these questions sound familiar? Well, they do swirl around if you think about this phrase, and lead us not into temptation, in the prayer. And I will say that this is probably one of the most challenging and to understand and misunderstood parts of the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. But it's been that way for a very long time. One example, one way that we know that, is in the New Testament book of James, which was written probably in the late first century, well after the Gospel of Matthew recorded the words of Jesus. We see this in James chapter 1. No one, when tempted, should say, "I am being tempted by God." For God cannot be tempted by evil, and He Himself tempts no one. It almost sounds like an argument to counter this part of the Lord's Prayer. Because already, even in that first or second generation church, Christians were having trouble wrapping their mind around the fact that God would lead or bring us into temptation as Jesus' followers. Another reason that we can see that from the beginning of the church, this prayer, this part of the prayer has been challenging, is that in ancient copies of the Bible, there's been some attempts to try to remedy that challenge or problem. As early as the 4th century, there are copies of the Bible that have been preserved where that's been edited just a bit by the person doing the copying. One such revision shows up in a 4th century copy. It says something like this: "Do not permit us to be led into temptation." You know, do not permit us, God. That has a very different take on it. But you know, there are earlier copies, some as early as the 2nd century of the New Testament, that have been discovered. And when we look at them in this part of Scripture, Matthew chapter 6, it is clearly this revision is not what Jesus said. And so from the very beginning, the church, Christians, followers of Jesus, have been challenged and have trouble with this part of the prayer. And maybe we do too. Lead us not into temptation. With all of this in mind that we've already shared, I think maybe taking a closer look at one word in this part of the prayer, temptation, I think it might bring us closer to a better understanding of what Jesus really had in mind as He was teaching His disciples and teaching us to pray this prayer. The word in English, translated in English, temptation, in the ancient Greek that this gospel was originally written in, is perosmon. Perosmon. And it has a meaning here of something like a temptation from without and within. A temptation that's coming either from outside or from inside a person that can be an occasion for a person to do wrong or to sin. So it's a temptation from without or within. And I think that's important to think through and note, because if we really think about our own experiences with temptation, and we're all tempted to sin in big and small ways, we know that that desire or that reason for the temptation can come from outside us. It can be something that we see or that we hear or that someone else is encouraging us to do, but they can also come from inside of us, the desires that we have for something that we really want. And it just helps us see that temptation is more of a challenge than we really would like for it to be. And it leads me to this. It leads me to say that sooner or later in the journey from temptation to sin, in that journey from being tempted to actually doing wrong, sooner or later in the journey from temptation to sin, we close off the rest of the world and it's just us and the temptation. It really is a journey, this process of temptation that bears fruit in sin or doing wrong against God or others. And we see that from the very beginning, way back in Genesis, in the story that is shared with us in the Bible about the first man and woman, Adam and Eve, who God placed in a beautiful, perfect paradise, the Garden of Eden. But they too were tempted to sin. And we see that play out in perhaps a familiar story where the tempter was portrayed as a serpent, a snake, and the tempter tempts Eve to take and eat of the fruit of a tree, the tree of knowledge of good and evil that God has forbidden Adam and Eve to eat from. And even though that temptation came first from the serpent, from the tempter, at some point in the process, in that story, it's just Eve, and she's trying to make that decision on her own. Does she sin, do what God has said not to do, or does she do what, you know, she really wants to do? In the same way with Adam, he comes along next, and he finds himself in the same situation as well. At some point, where it's just the temptation and him, what does he do? So really, it just tells us again that no matter the temptation, at some point, it's just going to be us. It is our call, just like it was Adam and Eve's call. And too often, I believe, we come to that point in the journey of temptation to sin. We come to it alone and by ourselves. And Adam Hamilton, pastor and writer Adam Hamilton, seeks to perhaps remedy that situation by actually suggesting that we pray this part of the Lord's Prayer just a little differently. Instead of praying, as is normally done when this prayer is prayed in church or maybe even by individuals, instead of praying, "Lead us not into temptation," where the emphasis is, it seems to be communicating that God can lead us into temptation, so we're pleading with God not to. Instead, Hamilton says, put a comma after "lead us" and pause after saying those first two words. So it would sound something like this. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. When we do that, the emphasis then turns to something else. The emphasis turns to our prayer of asking God to lead us, to be with us. Lead us so that even in temptation, which we all will have, even in temptation, we don't sin. So lead us not into temptation. You know, when we think of the prayer that way and say the prayer that way, the emphasis is no longer on the temptation per se, certainly not on God being the one who's leading us or bringing us into temptation, but rather the emphasis is on God, God leading us, God being with us, especially being with us and leading us and helping us when temptation comes in our lives. And we are all tempted. We've all been there. We've all been there when that temptation has come to us from outside of us or from within us. We've all been there when it's just the temptation and us. And so we're praying and asking God to lead us in a way that we do not sin. In other words, deliver us from evil. When it comes to that last phrase, but deliver us from evil, I really like what pastor and writer Olu Brown shares. He says that in our most trying moments, the question is, will you fully surrender to God, or will you try to win the battle of temptation yourself? If your answer is, and if you're honest, if I'm honest, it usually is this way, but if your answer is, well, I'm going to win it myself, chances are you will lose every time. Just think about the attempts in your life to change a behavior out of sheer willpower, especially something that has a negative effect. So the question has to be asked and answered. Will you fully surrender to God, or will you choose to try to win the battle yourself? And I think this matches up pretty well with what Jesus is trying to teach us in this part of the Lord's Prayer. Lead us not into temptation, God, but deliver us from evil. You see, to be delivered, to be rescued, we must surrender to and accept God, that God is greater than our circumstances, greater than the temptation that is before us, greater than our own desire to have or to do what we really, really want to do, even though we know it's not what God asks us to do or not do. We need to also accept that God is actively working, always actively working, to make a difference in our lives. And that's especially true when we find ourselves at this moment in the journey between temptation to sin, when we find ourselves at that moment where it's just us and the temptation. So in light of all of this, what I want you to do is I want you to bring God into that part of your journey, the part of the journey when it's just you and temptation. And I want you to allow God to truly lead you through it and out the other side. And you can do that in a couple of different ways. You can use that part of the Lord's Prayer just as a way to stop what you're doing and refocus. Or perhaps use this prayer, short prayer as well, as a way to stop, bring God into your life and into that moment of temptation. It should be on your screen now. Holy God of unconditional love and unlimited power and presence, I am fully available to you. You see, when we pray this prayer, it is, and actually try to spiritually and mentally do what we're praying, it allows us to turn away from that temptation and open ourselves up to God and to admit to God that we can't resist this temptation on our own. We cannot win that battle. But God can, because of His love, His power, and His presence. So say that with me again. The prayer. Holy God of unconditional love and unlimited power and presence, I am fully available to you. See, whenever you find yourself in this coming week at a place, at the point of the temptation to sin, when you're right there and making that decision, if and when we pray this, it is a way to turn to God and surrender ourselves to God's power and God's leading. And when we do that, we will find that we are beginning to live this prayer that we pray. So keeping all that in mind, I just ask you to think about all of that and that challenge for a few moments of silence, and then we'll move on. Now invite you to pray this prayer of a time of temptation. Pray this prayer out loud with me. I will then lead us into a deeper time of prayer that will end with us praying together the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray together. Holy God of unconditional love and unlimited power and presence, I am fully available to you. God, we confess, I confess, that too often we do not fully make ourselves available to you, surrender to you. And we confess that especially in times of temptation, that we do that and we seek to bring you and your unconditional love and all the power and presence that you can be into our lives. Forgive us and help us through the strength of your Holy Spirit to lean more fully into you and open ourselves up and surrender to you. And we thank you in advance for how in each one of those times you are faithful to us and you come to us, especially in that part of the journey where it seems like it's just temptation and us. We thank you for how you will add yourself to that equation. God, we just now want to continue to open ourselves up to you as we pray together the prayer that our Lord Jesus, your Son, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Hi everyone, Pastor Steve Blackshear here again. And as we begin to wind down our time of worship, I just want to remind you that there are many ways that you can give of your tithes and offerings. Give back to God part of what God has first given you through your financial giving to Wesley United Methodist Church. One of those ways is to actually bring or mail your check to the church office. And then you can also give safely and securely online through our website. Or you can also text to give through texting on your phone. And some details about each one of those last two options can be found on the back of the online worship bulletin. And I just also want to remind you that today, April 3rd, it is Communion Sunday here with Wesley UMC. And we are having a drive-through communion this afternoon, Sunday the 3rd, from 3 o'clock to 4:30. And so if you worship with us online and you're here in the Jefferson City area, I just invite you to come anytime in that time between 3 o'clock and 4:30 this afternoon. And I'll be here. I'll be waiting to chat with you, be in conversation with you, connect with you, and also share with you the sacrament of Holy Communion. I look forward to seeing you then. Finally, I just want to tell you one more thing. You know, we talked in the sermon today about praying a prayer that can help us invite God into our times of temptation. And that prayer is actually found in the online worship bulletin. So I just want to remind you again, you can go to that page on our website by clicking the link below the video feed. And in that, you might print off that worship bulletin and have that prayer with you. You know, Holy God, God of unconditional love and unlimited power and presence, I am fully available to you. As you go out this week in all of your life, but certainly in the moments of temptation in your life, as you go out to pray that prayer and open yourself, surrender yourself to God, go in the grace and love of God the Father. Go in the hope and peace of Jesus Christ that Jesus gave up everything for on the cross so that you could have. And go in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. It's yours now and forever. Amen. This is really messed up. Yep, I know. That'll get on the end.